Hi, welcome to another episode of Youth Diary. Every child is a gift of God, and motherhood brings meaning to our life. And to talk more about it, we have Dr. Vivek with us. He's an infertility specialist at Kinder Women Hospital, Chertala. Hello, Doctor. Welcome to our show.
Thank you.
Doctor, can you just tell us how important to be mentally and physically prepared before becoming a mother?
Yeah, it is very important to be mentally and physically prepared before becoming a mother, because you need to know physiologically what is happening to your body. You need to be mentally aware that a second life is within you. You need to take care of your own health and the health of your child. So basically it's a time when you are in charge of two lives at a point of time. So definitely a mental preparation and a physiological and physical preparation is very important when you are becoming a mother.
Okay. So we'll go to the questions, Doctor.
Doctor, I have a question. My friend is being married for 3 years and they have not got a child yet. Do they need to visit a fertility hospital?
I think they have married for 3 years and they haven't got a child yet.
Yeah. So whenever a couple marries and like they are staying together for 1 year and having regular unprotected intercourse, usually about 80 to 85% of such couple conceive within 1 year, and for 2 years around 90 to 92% of such couple conceive within a period of 2 years. So in this particular scenario, like the couple is married for 3 years and they've been trying for the last 3 years, so definitely at this point of time it is highly advisable that the couple definitely attends the fertility center and undergoes an fertility evaluation. Because why the condition is, because the most important single factor that might determine a fertility is the age of the couple. The higher the age, the less chances they might have a chance of fertility. As the age increases, the sperm, the quantity and the quality decreases, and the egg, the quantity and the quality of the eggs also keep on decreasing. So it is very important that they have an early treatment at this point of time and welcome, and they should attend a fertility center. I'll just briefly just explain what happens at a fertility center. The most important thing would be to come as a couple. There are many a times when only the wife comes when the husband is not there, so it becomes very very troubling, you know, like when a couple, because apart from the other usual checkups, infertility checkup is a condition where both the male and the female are evaluated at the same time. Anybody might be having a problem, so when they come together, always come as a couple. And basically we go through the history and a bit of examination, and then we go into the investigation part. And the investigation part basically for the male would be the semen analysis. The semen analysis needs to be given, and usually his semen needs to be collected within a period of 2 to 7 days after the last sexual intercourse. It should not be lesser than two days, because there's a chance that the count will decrease and the concentration will decrease, and not more than 7 days, because the motility will decrease and a lot of pus cells, everything keeps accumulating. So to get an adequate assessment of the semen analysis, he should do a semen analysis between 2 to 7 days. So that would be the single and the most important test for the wife, for the husband. And for the wife, she'll be having to do a little bit of investigation in the form of thyroid, prolactin, if she's having irregular periods. Then a scan would be advisable for her, preferably on the second or third day for periods. The scan is done mainly to have a look at the uterus, to see if there's any problems like fibroids, any cysts, to have a look at the ovaries, have an idea of her ovarian reserve. And then after that, if both these are okay, then the next important thing is to see whether the fallopian tubes of the wife is normal. So that might need a laparoscopic evaluation. And in most cases, around 80 to 90% of the couples, after this step is over, after these three steps are over, they might be able to pinpoint a diagnosis as to what the reason for the infertility could be. But there is another 10% of couples who might not have a reason yet. So it's called unexplained infertility. And still, in this case of unexplained infertility also, there are treatment options available. So the most important thing that I would like to say at this point of time is the most important thing. And after 2 years of staying together and trying adequately, definitely they should visit a fertility center and get themselves evaluated.
That means the earlier they come, the success rate is more.
The earlier they come, yeah, the success rate is more. Probably we can be able to offer more to the patient, and the chances of conceiving and the chances for us to options we have are also much are better if they come early. Yeah.
Okay, doctor,
let's
see the questions.
Yeah. My name is Vaishak. My question is, does radiation exposure and the mobiles and a laptop uses will reduce the fertility chances?
This is a very common concern that everybody has at this point of time, because we all use mobiles, we all use laptops. One of the main important problems as far as a fertility perspective is that the mobiles and the laptops, especially if they have a Wi-Fi connectivity, they release high frequency electromagnetic waves, and that those radiations have an effect on the male and the female fertility. Especially as far as male fertility goes, the radiations, they have something to do with the count of the individual. The semen count decreases, the motility decreases, even DNA fragmentation, a little bit of genetic component of the sperm gets altered when they are exposed to this radiation. And also a little bit of impotency factor and a little bit of erectile dysfunction issues also settle in when exposed to these radiations. Another problem is that, like when we are using a laptop, there's a lot of heat being produced by the computer, you know, with the laptop, and we are using it, that produces a little bit of heat, a considerable amount of heat on the scrotal region. In infertility, it is very important that the scrotal region should not be heated. I mean, the thing is that that has an adverse effect on the semen parameters. The concentration and the motility do get altered when increased temperature exposure is there. And many a times when there is Wi-Fi connectivity also in the computers and in the laptops that we use, many studies and research has shown that even 7 to 15 times the radiation exposure is increased to the body. So these are the problems, like while mainly using a laptop or a phone which has a Wi-Fi connectivity, and radiation also has something to do with fertility issues.
Okay, and doctor, how about these MRIs and X-rays?
Definitely, when there is when a couple get exposed to radiation in the form of MRI or in the form of X-rays, especially they have a lot to do with the, especially more so with X-rays. When the ovaries are exposed to the X-rays, they have a mutagenic effect on the ovaries. The eggs, the quality decreases. The genetic component of the eggs gets altered. And even for the sperm, the genetic, the DNA fragmentation increases and the motility decreases. So in these issues, definitely when, as far as possible, a couple who is planning to get conceived should try to avoid radiation. If due to any unfortunate situation they have to get exposed, then they should be using their proper lead aprons and taking the proper necessary preventive steps in order to do so. Because this is a very fragile period, this is a very delicate period in the lifetime of a couple when they are trying for a pregnancy. So they need to be like really very careful at this point of time.
Doctor, we have talked about MRI and X-rays. So definitely our audience will be have a doubt about abdominal scan and all those things. So how about it?
If we go through the physiology or through the basic physics of the ultrasound scan, be it transabdominal or transvaginal ultrasound that mainly we use for our infertility purposes, ultrasound scans, they work by a principle of using piezoelectric crystals. And the radiation per se by using these ultrasound scans is not that high. In fact, there is no radiation while we are doing an ultrasound scan to the body of a female. This is a false misconception that most of the couples do have, but fortunately, ultrasound scan has nothing to do with much of radiation exposure. Yeah.
We'll go to the next question, doctor.
My name is Anthony. Doctor, will smoking and alcoholism lead to infertility issues?
Smoking and alcoholism has a lot to do with the infertile couples. If you're talking about alcoholism, it has its own effect both on the male and on the female. As far as a male is concerned, the more, if he has a high dose of alcohol, it decreases the testosterone hormone level in his body. Thereby the erection, the impotence, he has a factor decreases. That is very much important as far as fertility issues are concerned. And even there are problems with the sperm also, the sperm motility, morphology also gets altered with a lot, with a heavy dose of drinking. For a female, as far as a female is concerned, when she, if she has alcohol, either mild doses or in moderate doses, it leads to a hormonal imbalance, and whereby her periods are altered, she gets irregular cycles. So on a whole, alcoholism should definitely be avoided by the infertile couple for a period of around 2 to 3 months before they are getting planning to get conceived. As far as smoking goes, be it active smoking or passive smoking, both are equally harmful for the couple. For a female, the time to conceive gets really, really prolonged. As I said earlier, around 1 to 2 years would be the ideal time when they should get conceived. But for a woman who is an active smoker or a passive smoker, the period for her to get conceived increases. It might increase from up to 3 years or even more. And for her, it has something to do with the acceleration and the speed of death, the accelerated apoptosis of her eggs. As a result, her menopause might get advanced. It might happen 1 to 4 years earlier. So all these problems are there if a woman gets exposed to cigarette smoke. For a male, this has a lot to do with the genetic defect of the sperm. There is a lot of DNA fragmentation again. The motility is very much decreased. So, on a whole, it might lead to a little bit of erectile dysfunction problems also. So both smoking and alcoholism are very much not advocated for any of the infertile couples. They should ideally abstain from smoking or alcohol for a period of around 2 to 3 months before they plan to get conceived.
Okay. How about this weight, doctor? Weight reduction or obesity in infertility issues?
Yeah. Obesity is very important. Obesity is a major problem in infertile couples, for the male partner and for the female partner. For the female partner, if she is having obesity or overweight, where her body mass index is more than 25, this has something to do with her hormonal imbalance and again menstrual irregularities. She should actively try to cut down excess fat. She should try to put down around 5 to 10% of her body weight. Just 5% of her body weight, if she's around to put around 7 to 8 kilos, that would do a world of a difference for her. So that is as far as female, for a female partner. For a male partner, if he is obese or overweight, this can again have a problem with the sperm count. Even up to 50% decrease of the sperm count is there for males who are obese or overweight, and also they have erectile dysfunction problems, this obesity contributes in a very bad way to the infertile couple. They should ideally have a good diet with a good healthy exercise and a healthy lifestyle is very, very much essential for these couples.
Okay, we'll go to the next question, doctor.
My name is Akshay. My question is the infertility treatment is expensive?
Infertility treatment, this is a very common notion that everybody has about infertility treatment as such. The first thing that anybody might say when you're talking about infertility treatment is about the expense part. But we must first identify the main scenario in which not all infertility treatment is expensive. And moreover, expense comes secondly. As I said, it is a time that is the most important thing. There is a time to sow, there is a time to reap. Similarly, there's a time for infertility, and you have to be very quick and very time bound in this infertility practice. When you're talking about cost, when a couple goes through the infertility management, there are many a times when just after the basic investigations are being done, there might be only a small variation in some of her blood hormones, a big thyroid, or a minimum problem with a sperm problems, which can be evaluated and can be treated at a very minimal cost. So you cannot blanket a statement like all infertility treatments are expensive cannot be made. There are many a time we encounter very small issues that can be taken care of very easily. And there are other treatment in infertility like intrauterine insemination, in which the sperm of the husband is processed, that is the pus cells the dead sperms are removed and the most viable portion of the semen is collected and it's passed through a catheter into the uterus, and that is called intrauterine insemination, where we are intrauterine, you are inseminating the husband's semen. So that is another treatment option that is very much useful and helpful in infertility cases, and in these cases it may not be that expensive either. Also there might be cases where the couple needs to go through laparoscopy or hysterolaparoscopy or fertility enhancing hysterolaparoscopic surgeries, and that too in per se might not be that expensive and might take care of a lot of issues that the couple has. It is only after these steps fail that we as infertility specialists think about IVF or artificial reproductive techniques. Artificial reproductive techniques are not the first line treatment, they are the third or probably the fourth line treatment after evaluating a couple. So every couple is a separate unit and we need to individualize the treatment according to the couple. And as a statement, as a blanket statement, infertility treatment as such is always expensive, may not be acceptable. Yes, artificial reproductive techniques are expensive, but that is, as I said, the third or fourth line treatment, which we consider in a couple only if the initial, all the methods have failed and the couple has no other chance.
Yeah. Doctor, can you just explain more about IVF or artificial?
IVF and it's in vitro fertilization, or if we talk about ICSI, it's called intracytoplasmic sperm injection. That all those come under the broad spectrum of artificial reproductive techniques, or ART. ART has a lot of techniques, of which one is IVF, one is ICSI, one is ZIFT. There are a lot of techniques that are being done. In IVF, what happens is that by using this technique, we are artificially, we are taking the eggs out of the female, out of the woman, out of the wife. We are taking the sperms out of the husband. In an artificial environment, the sperm is injected into the uterus, into the egg. The embryo is formed in the lab, and that embryo is seen, and the good quality embryos are transferred back into the uterus. So it's a condition where it's a physiological condition is being done in a in vitro setup. But there are a lot of ethical aspects involved in IVF treatment, and always we need to be very particular that the eggs that are being used and the sperms that are being we are using are of the same couple, and definitely a lot of ethical issues are involved, and a lot of malpractice definitely should be avoided in this particular case scenario.
Okay, in such cases, how long will be the treatment?
Infertility, the particular treatment as of ART, of IVF, is just in a particular month. Probably there might be the preceding 1 or 2 months, we might need to prepare the couple. We might need to do their basic investigations. We might need to give hormonal control for the wife for cycling. And the treatment per se of in vitro fertilization is just 1 month. It's just a particular month that we decide, and that we start off with the investigations, and with the on that particular month we start injections for the wife. The injections are being given to make the eggs grow larger in size, and to increase the yield of the eggs. High dose injections are being used where more eggs are collected, and when all the eggs are ready, then we collect the eggs, as we said earlier. The eggs are collected, then the husband's sperm is collected, the sperm is injected into the egg, the embryo is developed, and the embryo is transferred back into the uterus either on the third day or on the fifth day. So, and have to wait for another 2 weeks after embryo transfer to see for the blood test, and if the blood test is normal, it means that she has conceived. So the treatment as a whole for IVF will last for a period of around 1 month only.
So doctor, it was really informative. Thank you so much. So guys, write your suggestion to us. Our email ID is youthdairyroseball@gmail.com. See you next week.